Coming to you from an undisclosed location somewhere deep in the heart of the Santa Monica Mountains, I am your intrepid host, L.A. Marzulli. Join us for this incredible interview with Ben Calhoun. I was able to interview Ben Calhoun. He's a Christian recording artist. I think you'll find the interview very enlightening about what's really going on behind the scenes in so-called Christian music circles. It confirmed some of my suspicions, let me put it that way. So we'll get into this and so much more, but first a word from our trusted sponsor. Folks, have you taken a good look at the banks lately? On the surface, everything seems fine, but there seems to be a whole lot more going on underneath. It's like looking under the hood of a car and finding a mess of broken wires and parts. The parts are loans for homes, cars, and those credit cards we all use. Folks, they're hitting record highs. It's kind of scary when you think about it. Why risk your money for a tiny 5% return when things are so shaky? This is where Noble Gold Investments can help. They're like that friend who knows all about keeping money safe. They suggest gold and silver, oldies but goodies in the financial world. Plus, they've got a sweet deal, a free quarter ounce gold standard coin this month if you qualify. Pretty good stuff, right? If you're curious, just give them a call at 877-646-5347. It's just a chat, no pressure. They'll help you figure out if gold and silver are right for you. Or visit noblegoldinvestments.com. That's noblegoldinvestments.com. Once again, the number 877-646-5347. Folks, we've invested in Noble Gold, and quite frankly, I'm glad we did. So anyway, folks, here's the interview that I did at the Orlando Prophecy Conference with Ben Calhoun. I want to thank all the folks at Prophecy Watchers, especially Gary Stearman, Bob Ulrich, Mondo Gonzalez, all the incredible women who do all the shipping. I mean, Tyler Wood, you know, what do you say about Tyler? I mean, he's like, he's in some ways, he's the director of everything that you see because he's running all the cameras and sort of gives the thumbs up. So he's got a lot on his plate, and he does a great job. But thanks to all the folks at Prophecy Watchers, the Orlando conference was incredible. This coming weekend, on the 14th and 15th, I will be in Bentonville, Arkansas, and I hope to see you there. I'll be speaking Friday night and also all day Saturday with Q&As. So it's going to be a hoot. Sign up for it. Hope to see you there. In the meantime, here's my interview with Ben Calhoun. Ben Calhoun, thank you so much for joining us. You are a Christian musician, or a musician that's a Christian.
That
might be a better way to say it. Thanks for joining us. We're here at the Prophecy Watchers Conference, and you're playing and singing. Just give us a thumbnail sketch so our audience has an idea of who you are.
Great. Well, I have been an L.A. Marzulli and Prophecy Watchers fan for 13 years, and there's a great story there I think would be great for anybody who's interested in aliens and UFOs and the Bible, mm-hmm. and who wants to be set free from that stuff, as mm-hmm. I was. Mm-hmm. I started the band Citizen Way almost 20 years ago, so wow. A lot of people know me from that. You know, the K-Love thing and touring and all that kind of stuff. I've been on the road as a musician since I was about 14 in various bands, and then started touring nationally. When we got signed, and I told you I had a UFO story, but I used this story as part of my testimony to point people to what set me free, which is I always knew who and what it is and how, mm-hmm. but it became very real to me, and that's obviously Jesus, our Lord and Savior. So, and this is very poo-pooed in any Christian entertainment. They don't want to talk about this stuff. They just avoid it like the plague because, in my opinion, people stop putting money in the plates. It's uncomfortable. Pastors don't want to teach it. A lot of them don't even know about it.
Welcome to my world.
They right. don't talk about the supernatural. Right. They never touch prophecy because they want a church growth. They mm-hmm. want church growth. And I've played in a lot of the major churches in the country. I was just at one in Kansas City a few months ago where the pastor literally said, "Worship is for us," and I couldn't believe it. I got up there and I said, "No, worship is to glorify our Heavenly Father.
Our Creator.
In the name of Jesus, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit." That is, and we get to be, we do that. It's not for us. And I don't think they'll have us back, but oh well, you know, and he's wrong.
I completely could.
Yeah, and it's a heresy if you're in the context, absolutely. Especially if you're selling Jesus in that regard, which a lot of Christian entertainment is just selling Jesus. And anyway, I love what God has done in my family. My parents are committed followers of mm-hmm. Jesus. I've always had an issue calling myself a Christian, because apparently you can be a Buddhist or a New Ager these days and call yourself a Christian. So even since the time I was a little kid, I think it's because the Holy Spirit was drawing me, right? And my parents prayed for me. But they also gave me the example, God's word can be trusted from cover to cover. Mm-hmm. And if you know it, you'll know exactly what to do with your life. And for mm-hmm. me, it's always been the same. When I went and saw Petra and Jeff Moore and Carmen when I was a kid, get up on stage and tell people that Jesus loves them. I can't do my taxes, but I can do the song, right? So we get signed, fast forward years ago, I'm newly married, start the band. 8 years later, we get signed. I'm 1,000 songs in as a, you know, I'm touring and all that kind of stuff. And we finally get signed to one song. It's called Should Have Been Me. And my dad, you know, he's like, welcome to ministry, son. You know, and in a new way, you have a national platform now. Mm-hmm. I'm on the radio, mm-hmm. you know, it's a top five. We eventually had a couple of number ones.
Congratulations.
Well, thank you. But I'll honestly, glory to the Lord, because my mission was, I want to be like my heroes who put Jesus first. I am a follower of Jesus, and he gave me the gifts of gab and being on stage and singing songs. I think in songs. I communicate a lot easier that way. So I'm like, well, obviously it makes sense to do that, right? So we're on tour making, you know, $25 a show each. You know, two of us had kids at home. Great stories. There's so many wonderful things and wonderful people. And I was having these at home when I get off a tour. We lived in Chicago at the time. I was having some really scary demonic dreams. Mm. There would be figures in our bedroom, and I... To my waking eyes, mm-hmm.
they were there.
Black shadows were there, right?
The shadow people, sure.
Absolutely, mm-hmm. and I can see them snarling at me. It gives me goosebumps. Just jagged teeth. Hate.
Unmitigated hate.
Absolutely, and I was paralyzed in fear. We all know the story, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Now, going back a little bit, though, I had always been scared of aliens. Alien movies, talking about it. The movie Signs with Mel Gibson. Couldn't watch it by myself, but I was... absolutely entranced by it. I wanted to know this stuff, but I was scared at the same time. Mm-hmm. There were things that happened in my bedroom when I was a kid. There was a knock behind one of my pillows under my head. There's walls on both sides. I'm in the corner of my bed, and there's something knocks my pillow, right? I'm like, that just ain't right. Mm-hmm. I knew God's word. My dad, I watched my dad as a pastor, mm-hmm. use in the name of Jesus to help people confess their sin and be rid of the demonic entities that were in their life, right? Confession obviously does that. I knew what that was. So I wasn't scared of that, but I couldn't figure out how to deal with the alien thing in God's word. Mm-hmm. I didn't know what to do,
right?
But I was so scared of this. So fast forward, we're on the road. I'm sharing the gospel, lifting up the name of Jesus, not just grace and peace and mercy and love, which many Christian artists do. They won't say the name of Jesus because it's bad for business. Wow. True story. Some of them do, some of them don't.
Wow.
There are good people there. There really are. But the system is rigged, as all systems are.
And we'll get into that in just a little
bit. All they are. Yeah. Sure, Sunday morning's no different. Almighty dollar rules supreme, right? Mm-hmm. And I could not make sense with why I'm so scared of these demonic figures, these shadow people, mm-hmm. and aliens. I would have lots of dreams of UFOs attacking and crashing. Planes were always crashing. Before and after 9/11, so that really didn't have anything to do with it. And I was just scared. I would wake up sweating. I would also be paralyzed in fear. There were times when they were choking me.
Yeah.
And I could not, mm-hmm. and I knew how, but I could not say the name of Jesus.
Yeah, I've experienced
right?
that. It's terrifying.
So, and that story is pervasive. There's a lot of those stories. Well, I was experiencing that. I went to my father, who is a wonderful man of God, who was rescued from the Catholic Church when he was in his 20s at college. Amen. My wife too. Because of a personal relationship with Jesus, not a religion.
Right.
My dad grew me up to know God's word. My mom and dad, they prayed for me. They showed me what it's like to follow Jesus, not just go to church and be a pew warmer, to believe it. And he said, well, son, is there any hidden sin in your life? Are you giving the enemy a foothold? I said, well, Dad, no. Not that I can think of. He said, well, let's pray and ask the Holy Spirit to reveal it, if there is.
Okay.
But also to give you the direction you need to eradicate this fear. So we did. And the Holy Spirit in that process really impressed on me, just the silent way he does. Hey, you remember you always liked studying about giants in the Old Testament? And Genesis, you know, and specifically Genesis 6. And so I started to read and I started to research In Steps, prophecy in the news back then,
right,
which is now Prophecy Watchers, L.A. Marzulli, Gary Stearman, Chuck Missler.
Right.
My friend Seth turned me on to Chuck Missler. He's a famous producer now. And I learned that Genesis 6, obviously with the Nephilim, I've always been intrigued by that. It's in the Bible, right? So you can't ignore it. I believe it cover to cover, right? I learned that those demonic spirits of the dead Nephilim roam this earth.
They
They're basically trapped to this
they
terrain.
They are the demons.
Right?
The demons that
they are the demons that masquerade as whatever, including little green guys and black shadows
that's
and
right.
UFOs.
Absolutely.
When I figured that out, L.A., thank you, God, for giving me L.A. to help me do this, because you were instrumental. Your name is on a brick in my foundation, by the way.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. When I figured that out, like a light bulb, my fears went away.
Wow. How old
and it was like I was 33.
Wow.
13 years ago.
Let me jump in here. We'll, you know, we come at these conferences and we hear stories. People come up and go, you know, and they give us accolades and tell us how our books and DVDs have made such an impact. But see, we, you know, I'm usually in my studio in an undisclosed location somewhere deep in the Santa Monica Mountains. And so we there's comments in the comment sections, but there's no person there. There's no interaction. Yeah. And so when we come to these conferences and people like yourself, all of a sudden, you know, tell us that we were instrumental in some way. It's just like, you know, glory to the King, because it's not us doing it, you know. It's incredibly, and I really mean this, very sobering, really sobering.
Yes.
Because realize it's like, wow, Lord, you've raised me up for the position for such a time like this. Who am I? I'm nothing.
Right.
You know, just a dust in the wind, quoting Kansas. But I mean, that's what I am. And anything I am or became is because of what he's done in my life.
Amen.
End of story.
Amen.
That's why I never understood. You remember when you're a new Christian and you get to the book of Revelation and the elders are casting down their crowns? And you're kind of, what's wrong
with
you?
Yeah, like, why? Isn't that
good?
Don't we get rewards?
Yeah, I mean, what's wrong with you people, right? I totally get it.
Yeah.
I totally get it. It's like you can't get rid of that thing fast enough because you know
it's all glory to God.
Where it is. You know, my first mentor, Wayne Kendall, used to say, he used to go, well, God's playing catch with you, L.A., but you got to throw the ball back to him like this. You can't hold on to the ball.
I love baseball, so great.
Yeah, so there you go, right? And what's amazing is it's exactly it.
Mm.
You know, he'll give us something, but we've got to throw it back. We can't hoard onto it and think it's our own because it's not.
The relationship part comes in there.
Yeah, there it is.
Yeah.
It's an ongoing walk with the Lord. Yep. Let me ask you something. You know, you're involved in Christian music, and you and I kind of talked, which has set this whole interview up sort of thing. Air One, and we're not bagging on Christian music, but we are bagging on Christian music on some level. So I'm a classically trained pianist. It's very difficult for me, and I'm also a worship leader for 25 years, like you.
Mm-hmm.
And all I ever wanted was to make it in the Christian music industry. Mm-hmm. And the Lord just kept going, no, but that's not what you're supposed to do. Just trust me and come over here. So here we are. I get it.
Mm-hmm.
But I have a huge trouble listening because it's four chords, the same four chords, endlessly played over and over and over again with this wall of sound, huge production thing behind it. What are your thoughts on the current state? And there's some great songs out there.
I mean, you know, Jira, and great people.
Yeah, great people. Jira, Carrie Jobe's Revelation song, one of my favorites. I Raise a Hallelujah. I recite that every single night at 3 o'clock in the morning with my hands raised. It's a worship song, and I know some people go, well, look at these, you know, the signs and wonders and all this stuff. Just everybody, calm down. You know, I believe in the gifts of the Spirit, and I travel on them. But all that to say, you know, you get the same four chords endlessly repeated. All the songs sound alike. They're homogenized. What are your thoughts?
Well, there's a lot of ways you could spin this or skin this cat, right? I think the most important thing is to always remember, obviously, all glory to the Lord. But as a follower of Jesus, if you claim to be such, then it's a requirement to know the Word. Otherwise, you don't know Jesus because he is the Word, John 1, right? So I think there is a genuine, like preschool at best in some ways, level of understanding of God's Word by most of American Christians. Christians, right? And again, people who go to church, it doesn't make you a Christian, are disciples of Jesus, right? Mm-hmm. So I think that's the real start there. Like, as a listener, do you know God's word? Do you know the difference between the truth and not just the lie, but the truth and the almost truth? Mm. I think a lot of Christian music is almost truth, in my opinion.
Okay.
There are amazing people who want to serve the Lord, right? They want to lift up the name of Jesus. They don't want to just say grace, peace, mercy, love, and Jesus is my boyfriend, right? Which is the topic of songs, right? Here's where I think the big part of it is that's difficult to overcome as an artist or as a fan or promoter. You have people who are being worshipped, right? You also are in an industry that is still about making money. The almighty Luciferian all-seeing eye dollar. That's the bottom line. If it doesn't make money, the record contract is done. Everybody is grasping for that lead position, that lead singer, the band, or whatever. Well, Christian music is different. It helps sometimes to get a little bit of an understanding of what Christian music is and what it's not. Christian music is defined by one thing, in my opinion. The lyric, right? It's not the music. It's not who's playing it. It's not the sound of lights. All that's the same as all the other industries. The lyric is the difference. Mm-hmm. If the lyric is not, in my opinion, based off of God's word, and as much as verbatim as you can, you know, and not that you can't do that and still worship the Lord, of course you can. Testimony songs, love songs. One of my favorite things to do is listen to Stephen Curtis Chapman sing about his wife Mary Beth, a love song. Mm-hmm. I know Stephen. I've met Mary Beth, but Stephen and I used to have the same manager. He's a wonderful man. He cried with me when we lost our son Jeremiah. Oh. He's a wonderful man. I grew up on that. There are bricks in my foundation with his name on it, you know? He's a great guy. There's none of that anymore. So the industry has obviously changed into now a worship setting. Mm-hmm. In my opinion, worship music killed classic Christian music, or CCM. And that's not a slam on worship music. What I'm saying is the business side of it. Hear me loud and clear, all you people who think I hate worship music. I saw it from an artist's point of view, watching fans and artists and promoters. You know, you're one way off stage, you're another way on stage. Believe me, I've had to work against that as an artist myself.
Oh, we all do.
We all do.
Right?
I mean, there's a performer thing.
I'm a sinner saved by grace.
Bingo.
When I go up in front of an audience and I'm presenting, you know, there's an anointing there. I totally get it. I've learned this from friends of ours.
Yes.
I mean, I take 3 steps back from this platform. This is yours. I mean,
absolutely.
There's an anointing for that period of time. And the rest of the time, I'm dealing with, you know, me.
Yes.
And my sin nature. And,
absolutely.
And, you know, and making sure that at least I'm accountable to my wife and to some peers. Because it's, you know, walking is, you know, at 73 years old, I mean, you know, we all groan to be set free.
Amen.
Really be set free.
Amen.
Where there is no sin nature. So pick it up from there.
Well, I think it comes down to the almighty dollar, honestly. Worship music makes a lot of money.
Lots of money.
A lot. Yeah. And it is frustrating to know that and go to a church that does it. And it's hard not to know that.
Yeah.
Well, right? Now, is there good that comes from that? Of course there is. Otherwise, Romans 8 would be a lie. Mm-hmm. He either works together all things for good for, you know, to our good, according to his purpose and his plan, right? Which he foreknew and predestined, right? Or he doesn't. So can he use even evil? Of course he will. And he does, and he says he will. So of course he can use all of that industry that is centered around selling Jesus, which is a real issue. Worship music has become the front and center. I don't think it's as much of a movement of God as people think it is. I think it's the almighty bank account. Because look, just follow the money. You know, there are no, I mean, Air One used to be a rock station. There are no rock bands left. There's Legacy at best, a few of them. Skillet and Disciple, great people there, by the way, both those camps. And if maybe a few others. There's nothing other than like what's been there and has survived the worship thing and has legacy stance now, like some artists do, or worship bands. And those worship bands, I mean, I understand it, but it's difficult to make it in the music industry anyway. You're selling, you're glorified t-shirt salesman on the road anyway. When you cut it down from the management, business management, road management, and everything, there's nothing left.
Wow.
So that CCLI number is attached to all the churches obviously paying dues to play those songs. I mean,
and that's what it's about.
Unfortunately, it's not saying that everybody has that motivation. Mm-hmm. Certainly the artists and writers don't always have that. But it's there nonetheless.
You know, it would be interesting, and I'll give you the last word here because I like to keep interviews pithy so they don't go on for hours, and we could go on for hours. It's just, I find it interesting how the church needs a renaissance, a rebirth on so many different levels, and music is certainly one of them. I mean, I know that there are classically trained people out there, people who are great musicians and will never get a shot at doing anything. So I don't know how it works. I don't know how we, you know, create some sort of a platform where other music can be heard. I mean, inspirational music. I mean, I'm like I said, I'm a classical jazz pianist, so I have a little YouTube channel. I mean, my normal stuff on this YouTube channel is like 212,000 people. That's a big audience, but the music is probably, I don't know, a couple thousand people there or whatever.
Right.
It doesn't transfer, and that's okay. Mm-hmm. But I write these compositions, and they're all instrumental, but they're virtuosic. They're really hard to play. Mm. And I mean, there are cellists and violinists and oboist. I mean, there's a whole group of people, and all that has just been sort of set aside because of the genre that we see. And people, and I'm sort of bagging on this. I'm a musical snob, I guess, and that's I try to work with that all the time. But I mean, we're so dumbed down musically that if you sat the average Christian down and played him a Bach fugue, they wouldn't know what to do.
I have
with
no
that.
Idea.
No idea.
No.
And this is problematic because this is Western. This is Western music. Bach's the father, in my opinion, the father of Western music. Mm. And so it's just been dumbed down and dumbed down and dumbed down and dumbed down even more to the point where it's the same four chords endlessly played. I'll give you the last word, and thanks so much for coming on the record.
Oh, all right, my pleasure. And by the way, I did see a UFO over my backyard.
We're going to talk about that.
It wasn't a plane.
We're going to talk about
that. So, pastors of big churches, big box churches, of which I've played in many of them, and again, there are really good people there.
Sure.
But it's not, there's a 10 to 20% of people who want to be disciples of God through the name of Jesus and know the word. Everybody else is there for other reasons. Some are there just to be entertained. But that worship leader or that pastor, whoever's in that lead singer position, pastor, whatever, there is a drug called fame that is difficult to get outside.
Amen.
It is the most addictive that I know of. And having experienced that myself as a lead singer of a band, when people worship you, it feels good. There is an element of that that is difficult to even recognize when you're in the Christian entertainment business, which is it's a business. If you don't have good people around you to help you be aware of that, or if you don't know God's word yourself, it will just sweep you. You'll be taken for the ride and do years of ministry in many cases, and you will sacrifice whatever because you feel like you're doing the good for the Lord. But I've watched a lot of divorces happen. I've watched a lot of fathers not be there. You know, one of the reasons I came off the road in 2019 is because Liv was born, our little one. And I'm like, I don't want to miss that. So I abandoned my career in some ways. We also got dropped that year from our label. The band got, it was just split up. It was just a nightmare in some ways. Wow. However, I was like, well, it's very clear that I need to go home. And I'm so glad I did. My daughters know me. We tour now as a family.
Wow.
And I think that is the thing that is the most important is instead of highlighting all the evil, we focus on what has God called us to do. And I make a lot of records. Artists ask me all the time, you know, I want to do this. I said, well, are you willing to do it if nobody listens? Are you willing to do it if you have no spins on radio, Spotify, whatever?
I know.
If you're willing to do that, then you're in the right place.
Yeah.
Because think of, you know, go into your prayer closet, pray to the God who hears you, nobody else. There's an element of that, I think, that most musicians don't carry with them into the studio or on stage. Because that allure of that drug, that hit of fame is so, it feels so good. And I think the challenge then to us as Christian people with a pulpit, with a microphone, whatever it is, can we utilize that to point people to Jesus?
Amen.
Paul said it best, I think, follow me as I follow Christ.
Mm.
So I think that's our job, our gifting, to use our platforms to do that. That's why we utilize those evil things like Instagram and Facebook and Spotify. They're all gonna get taken away anyway.
Yeah.
I was shadow banned for being pro-life in 2020. I knew what happened. We lost friends and all that kind of stuff. It's amazing to me though how that sifts. But you cherish then the friendships that you're built on the solid foundation of Jesus, right? You cherish things like Prophecy Watch. You cherish God's Word.
It's our tribe.
And watch the songs come all new again. And I would challenge and encourage pastors to get away from the big box church songs. There's a lot of witchcraft that's going on at those big three. You know what they are. And it's being taught that way. And people are getting swept by it. I would encourage you, you have the best songbook there was, God's Word. Write your own songs for your community.
That's it.
It does not matter and if they compare to whatever. Who cares if it's out of tune when you have volunteers singing? It doesn't matter the heart, right? Make a joyful noise, the Bible says.
Amen.
And study. Like, become the best possible bass player you can be. Memorize the music. Get off of the stand and look at people.
Mm-hmm.
Use your eyeballs and connect with people.
Amen.
And just do the simple relationship thing that we have with Jesus. And watch him do the rest. It's his job anyway.
Thanks so much for coming on. Appreciate it. God bless you, Ben. God bless you.
Thanks so much for watching. Remember, the Roswell films are there as long as you can go to our streaming site, streaming.lamarzulli.net. Streaming.lamarzulli.net, what are you waiting for? This is real journalism, as several people who have seen the films have stated. There's a lot of information there. It clears up what really happened in 1947. In our opinion. Thanks so much for watching. We'll be back again tomorrow or the day after with more incredible interviews. There's another one with Ben Calhoun. I think you'll find this interesting. He had a UFO experience.